Okay, welcome to the H-Frame podcast with my old friend Ira Richmond. Ira is one of my best friends ever, and we met a long time ago, and today we're going to do a book review of the Beastie Boys book, their sort of tome that they put out a couple of years ago, and we're going to talk about the Beastie Boys, their history, how they're reflective of popular culture and the changes of the last really 30 years, and I think they're a good sort of tapestry to talk about the pop culture, the changes, because they've been through everything in the 70s, 80s, 90s, and even in today, you know, where a band, not many bands can write a 600-page memoir. So we're going to talk about that. So Ira, welcome, and you ready to go?
Yeah, it's awesome to see you, man. I had my 50 cups of coffee, so I'm ready to go.
Okay. What's that poem behind you? Maybe we can explain that because people are going to ask. You got a cat behind you. What's your cat's name?
My cat's name is Gilda.
Okay. Hi, Gilda. Yeah. Yeah. And what's your poem about? Yeah.
And this is this piece of art from the lead singer of a local band called Run Lusty Run. That was a band that's predominantly around in the 90s. And the lead singer was also an artist.
Did you know this? Did you know these guys? You know,
Oh, personally, I was just a fan.
Okay, but that's in the Soul Asylum, the Husker Du Minneapolis sound. You know that?
Absolutely, yeah. They were probably the most rock and roll of all the bands that were known. They're possibly the least known that is the most known locally.
Okay, so we're talking
least known nationally, most known locally.
You're joining us now from Minneapolis, so welcome, and your cat can join us as long as she is patient enough. So let's begin. So we're going to talk about the Beastie Boys, but why don't we start with how we met? We met a couple of weeks after Check Your Head was released, and we met in Alaska. And what do you remember about that job?
Well, that job was, you said that... you know, one of your best friends and, you know, best friends are frequently made when you go through a lot together. And we went through a lot together in a very short time. So it was, I think 6 weeks of maybe 16 or 17 hour days of cutting, fixing salmon that had been miscut by the salmon cutting machine.
Okay. We're basically we're on an assembly line and we're in the most remote part of Alaska where we had to take a bush plane to get there. Do you remember taking that plane out there and we landed on a runway that was dirt and then we got
absolutely
out?
I remember I was sitting in the front and the pilot told me, actually I think he handed me the fire extinguisher, and then the entire time we were flying he was only flying with one hand and he was eating a sandwich with the other,
and we were flying like literally like 100 yards over the tundra. You know, it was really and the guys, they said, oh, this is our local taxi service, we do this every day, you know. So
yeah, and I think actually being an Alaskan bush pilot was at that point the most dangerous profession in the world.
Yeah, and I remember I think Northern Exposure was popular at the time and Maggie O'Connell was sort of a bush pilot. He goes, no, it's nothing like that. The guy says, I'm a real bush pilot, you know. And but we met and we worked together in Alaska and we stood together, you know, literally 17 hours a day cutting fish, but we could talk to each other even though it was an industrial job, and we got to know each other pretty well. But I remember one time early on, we were playing basketball because there weren't enough fish yet to work a full day. So we had some free time and we played basketball outside on a dock. And there was just a makeshift plywood backboard with a hoop nailed to it, not even a net. And we found a volleyball or something and we started shooting hoops. And you asked me if I knew anything about basketball. And I asked you why. And you said, because the Beastie Boys were into basketball. And I said, you know, that band from, you know, I remember them from the bad days from the 80s. And what was your memory about that? Do you remember why you were influenced by Check Your Head? You know,
I must have at that point have known that in the Check Your Head recording studio and process that they had built a basketball court into the recording studio that they made. And so I loved football, but I knew very little about basketball. And I remember we went out to shoot hoops. And my main question for you was, where do I look at the, you were very kind and very patient instructor. Cause I remember asking you, where did I look? Did I look at the ball when I was shooting or did I look at what part of the backboard? And you were the first person to tell me that you were supposed to look at the rim. And some people thought you looked at the front and some people thought you looked at the back, but you had a theory about it being related to, hunting skills and how people used to have to throw projectiles to hunt, to get their food. And that's where that skill came from.
That's true. And I told you that story and it's true. Always aim for the front iron of the rim and you never lose. Same with free throws. And I told you that and you said, wow, that's really true. And I said, it is really true. And that was the next day, I think we started our 17-hour.
That was the calm before the storm. I was trying to, when I was thinking about discussing this, I was trying to think about why we would have had time to shoot baskets, because that was not representative.
No, because we were painting the docks because Sabrina, our boss, was trying to give us something to do so we could make money instead of just sitting around doing nothing. Because if you sat around up there, you didn't make any money. So anyway.
Yeah, well, that was kind of our warm up to just, we ended up standing next to each other for so many hours and discussing so many different things. And you were like a compendium of the past and the present and the wide latitude that you had culturally of what you could discuss was really interesting. And what you didn't know, you were extremely interested in, which was fascinating to me, which is, I think, how we ended up having such good conversations, because you knew what you knew, but you were also interested in what I knew that you had yet to experience.
And one of those was Paul's Boutique, because you gave me the cassette that day. Right. I think we had cabins. And if you don't know what it's like living in South Naknek, Alaska, it's like you lived on these elevated cabins. They barely had any insulation. Do you remember these cabins we lived in? You lived on one side.
Yeah, we called them chicken coops.
Chicken coops, right? They were elevated and we'd have to put the newspapers because it was light 23 hours a day and we couldn't sleep. But you gave me Paul's Boutique, and that's where we can start this conversation, because I listened to it and I said, there's so much information in this album that's incredible that somebody could do this, because these kids were from the 70s, but they also had a lot of pop cultural references, but a lot of like 70s references. You know, they had references that people wouldn't know, and I think people still don't know. So we'll cut it there. And then first of all, I want to ask, maybe we can tell a little bit about your background, because you're kind of an unusual guy. You're not a normal American guy. You grew up in Germany, right? What was that like?
It was fantastic. It was like the best of both worlds. My mom is Dutch Indonesian, and my dad was from Brooklyn, and he was overseas as part of the military, and they met. So I got to have a sort of American European existence, through middle school. It was really wonderful.
And you grew up on a military base in West Germany. What city?
Well, I was born in Stuttgart. We lived in a number of different places, but the last place we lived was Heidelberg. But they didn't really have a base system like we're used to in the States. The housing was really mixed in with the German city portion, and there would be barracks where the military people would work.
So you grew up, and I remember you told me a story. If you don't want to tell it, that's okay. But I remember you told me a story because your father's Jewish, right? And somebody was talking about what I can't remember the story. What was your teacher talking about?
I think it was an explanation of the difference between, not the difference, but sort of the, Hanukkah comes at about the same time as Christmas. I think it was fifth grade, and I think it was a well-meaning discussion about what Hanukkah was, and sort of trying to be inclusive to those of us that may have had some Jewish heritage. Yeah. this was Germany, and the reason that we're that NATO was there, Americans were there at all, was because World War II, and understand the context of that. Even though it was many years later, it was still the foundational element of it. So at some point during this discussion, the teacher was looking for some context from, the people who may have had some Jewish heritage in the class. So she, asked anybody who was Jewish if they could stand up. And so, there was like three of us that, you know, very slowly, like very hesitantly, we're like, I don't know if we're supposed to do this. I think that's what we were all thinking, was like, you know, isn't this what, you know, got us in trouble in the first place? So, you know, so we stood up and as fate would have it, none of us were standing next to each other. So there was like a triangle of us that had never even considered who else in the class was Jewish. And we just looked at each other in like sort of, you know, bewilderment.
I know. I mean, it's dark gallows humor now, but you told me that story in Alaska, and I remember I was kind of laughing, but I didn't really want to laugh. But the way you told the story was really funny. Like, hey, we might as well put a gold star on us, you know, or something like that.
Yeah. Well, it's that point where you don't really know how you're supposed to behave, but you had some remnants of adult conversation that maybe indicate that you're not doing the right thing.
And how old were you at that time?
I was 10.
Okay, so you didn't have any concept, but you told me later that she was a pretty serious person because she had to translate during the 1972 Munich Olympics, right?
Yeah, we had a lot of great, I mean, it was a great school system. We had our German teacher at the time was a translator for the 72 Olympics in Munich, which I didn't know anything about. And, you know, in fifth grade, you know, because in Europe, you're so much less shielded than you are in the United States from world events. And so, you know, in fifth grade, you know, we basically had a teacher tell us about what had happened with the hostage situation in 72. And I'd never heard of it.
And that was one of my first memories as a child. And I was watching that and it was terrifying. And if you don't know the background, you can look it up, but the 1972 Munich Olympics were a terrible event. And it was dealing, you know, in Munich, they put the Olympics there and Israeli athletes got murdered and they basically just went on with the Olympic Games. I mean, it was a really strange event. And my earliest sports memory was that. So maybe we can get away from that and then talk about, but I think my basic point is you're not typically raised in an American household.
I had been around, Europe. I'd lived in Holland. I'd also lived in the heart of the United States in Colorado for a bit. And I think I had adapted to a number of different places.
Okay. So you go to America and let's cut to the Beastie Boys. We'll get to them. And because they're kind of an interesting story too. You've seen them a number of times and you've even met Ad Rock, which we'll get to later, but you have a kind of an interesting experience with them that you came to the United States when did you move to the United States? So
82.
So the 80s, the Beastie Boys come out of this 1970s New York culture. And how would you describe that? I mean, this is if you've seen Taxi Driver.
Gritty. That's how I would call it gritty and full of opportunity and also full of risk.
Okay. So we're talking about the Andy Warhol culture of the artsy Velvet Underground in the 60s. And then it morphs into something grittier, kind of the punk Taxi Driver, mid 1970s era, which was the time that they really came of age, right? They're kids at that time. But
yeah, I think there was a lot of urban decay. And at that point, you know, it's like a stock where you buy low, sell high. But at that point, nobody knew the stock of New York City was ever coming back, right? So you had Escape from New York. You had a lot of nihilist like pop culture movie things. You had punk rock. It was the down part of the roller coaster where you didn't know if it was coming back up.
And there's a lot of crime. I remember Johnny Carson would begin his monologue every night with about Central Park. You don't go there after sundown. You know, Howard Cosell was talking about it on Monday Night Football, how the Bronx is on fire. There's Taxi Driver. I mean, that film is not a work of fiction. I mean, that was really what New York looked like in the 70s.
Yeah. And I mean, if you could place it in context of what we know now and how New York's been for a while, you could get an apartment or a club space in Manhattan for a dime. I mean, if that's unimaginable.
And so there was a lot of art that came out of that grit, right? There's CBGBs, there's the Ramones, there's Talking Heads, Blondie, Patti Smith. They're all in this strange little cocoon of Manhattan and New York that is falling apart, but there's a lot of art that's coming out of this. So I think the Beastie Boys come out of that in the late 70s when it's starting to change, and there's new wave, and there's kind of the hip hop culture, but it's still underground in the early 1980s. And that's where they kind of come out of, right? This whole, we talked about it last time where Blondie had a top 40 song called Rapture, where she actually references Fab Five Freddy, right? And that's that New York gritty, but increasingly multicultural aspect of the underground hip hop scene, but nobody knows.
Yeah, there was an uptown scene and a downtown scene, and the downtown scene was sort of the artier, gayer, maybe more disco scene, more rock scene, and uptown was I think strictly disco and sort of more of a proper, I don't know if you would call it more affluent scene, but then those scenes apparently started to mix, and that's where that explosion came from.
Yeah, and I've always heard the link was that Fab Five Freddy was the link there. Like he connected the Warhol people with the hip hop people down, and Madonna got mixed up in that a little bit, and suddenly it became kind of gelling into something different. But the Beastie Boys were teenagers in the early 1980s, and they were hardcore. But let's face it, in hardcore, if you have a hardcore band, you don't really have to be a good musician. You just have to have a place to rehearse.
Absolutely. I think that's what made it a really accessible entry point for them was, you know, they were without need to have, I don't want to say skill, because that, I think that that's inaccurate to put it like that, but a learned skill, let's put it that way. So you could start a band without knowing much about playing your instrument and learn how to play it on the way, but you could also learn how to be a live performer and have a reason to get your friends together and have a party.
And there are no rules in New York City in the early 1980s. There are no rules, right? There's the city's transitioning into the Reagan era a little bit, and punk was a way, hardcore was a way of rebelling against these early Reagan years. Let's face it, the Beastie Boys didn't have a lot of material needs, but they had a lot of intellectual angst, and they started to play in a band, right? Let's talk about some of these bands they played in. When was the Young Aborigines? What do we know about that band? Do you know that?
The Young Aborigines, and I think the other one was called The Young and the Useless.
Yeah, so. But that shows you that there's kind of ironic, even in the early 1980s, they're playing on this irony theme. It's The Young and the Useless. There's a soap opera, if you don't know. It's called The Young and the Restless, but that's Ad Rock's band.
Yeah, right? And I think the young Aborigines ended up morphing into the Beastie Boys, and then Ad Rock was a guitar player for The Young and the Useless, and he ended up coming on board when one of the founding members, John Barry, left.
Okay. And then there's probably in the early 1980s in New York, let's face it, there's probably a lot of cocaine. There's probably a lot of booze. There's probably a lot of, bands that have no business playing, but they just play anyway. And
I think it's a real mix of what strata these kids are coming from. And there's sort of a discussion about whether they have an affluent background. I think maybe a lot of them, best way to describe their affluence is that maybe they had a safe home to go back to.
Yeah.
But what's interesting about New York is that in other places, frequently in, you know, what you associate for Southern California is that you, when you're affluent, you are shielded in a bubble. But in New York at that time, even though they had a stable or possibly upper middle class or affluent home to go to, they were allowed to like roam the city by themselves at night from basically 12 on, which is, you know, impossible to think of now.
And I remember when we were playing basketball in that dock in Alaska, I brought up the book, The Basketball Diaries of Jim Carroll, which had not been a film yet with DiCaprio, but it was a it was a book that I read, you know, I don't know, when I was 20 or something. But it talks about being a basketball player and a heroin addict in 1960s Manhattan. You know, he's playing against Lou Alcindor, and Jim Carroll eventually was affiliated with Patti Smith
his lifestyle that he describes in that book, you know, it carries on through the 70s and into how the Beastie Boys describe their young teenage years. I mean, you know, they got out, they lost some friends, but they got out somewhat unscathed in terms of having some sort of life-changing substance abuse problem or having something tragic happen with the amount of risky behavior that they had.
And I heard Adam Yauch, MCA, say that one of the things that they learned in the early 1980s was that bands that were around in the mid 70s didn't last because they just burned themselves out. I mean, almost literally with drug overdoses or something like that. So
the Sex Pistols and the Dolls.
And I think they really had a lot of Sex Pistols in them, in the fact that being kind of raunchy and rowdy got attention. And that's the whole thing about hardcore and punk. You know, I went to one of those shows in the 80s at CBGB's, and I couldn't tell the difference between if they were doing the warm-up or sound check or in the actual performance. Nobody really cared. It was just the scene. And I think that's the scene they came up in. And you told me a story about Rat Cage Records. What do you remember about that place?
Well, they were, Rat Cage Records was a record store in Lower Manhattan that apparently acted as their clubhouse, and the owner of it was very supportive and interested in music and the kids that were interested in music. So they got to have that sort of as what would have been, you know, the malt shop to go hang out in and experience it. And so that is where the Beastie Boys got their I think first record deal, is that, you know, they decided that, you know, the owner of Rat Cage Records decided that they could support these kids in making and recording music.
And that was really a break for them, because they admittedly, I mean, they all say that we didn't really know what we were doing. We just were playing, you know, in a band because we wanted to be in a band. And they gave them a chance to actually put something on vinyl, right? And a place to hang out until 4 a.m, you know, in
Absolutely,
Manhattan.
Yeah. And, you know, they ended up recording, I think it was, the story was that it was a friend of Adam Yauch's parents owned a jingle recording studio. And that's where they ended up getting two free nights to record the music that they had. And they went in there and recorded, you know, the hardcore songs that they had written or that they were covering. And they said it took about 20 minutes. And after that 20 minutes, they realized that, you know, those songs weren't very good. And so then they spent the second night recording some originals that they sort of made on the fly. One of them was Cookie Puss, which ended up being like a club single and sort of marked their transition away from a hardcore band into, you know, they started to become what was the early version of Club Kids, hanging out at Danceteria in Manhattan, getting exposure to different types of music.
And music's got to go somewhere, because in the late 70s, we're coming out of disco. And Led Zeppelin breaks up in 1980. So there's got to be some direction that music's going to go. It's got to go one way or the other. And punk really wasn't sustainable. Even if you think about Blondie and the Ramones at least had Phil Spector to polish them up, and the Talking Heads, all those kind of bands eventually morphed into pop bands, Blondie being the most important one. And they kind of, you know, in 1983, if they did Cookie Puss, they had two ways of going. You could go hardcore and nobody's going to listen to you, or you could jump onto this new thing called hip hop, which they did because they met Rick Rubin, right? That was their key to this crossover. Getting in touch with Run DMC was from Hollis, Brooklyn, and the Russell Simmons, and this whole idea of Black culture mixing with kind of New York white culture. And there's something that came out of that. And that was all included in with Madonna and Aerosmith, and all of that stuff from 83 to 84 to 85 is really important. And Rick Rubin was kind of the key to that transition, right?
Yeah, he was. I mean, he brought in a rock element along with Run DMC into rap, which, you know, coming off the 70s, you had the disco sucks movement.
Yeah.
And anytime you had a disco sucks type movement, which is something that was maybe too smooth or too danceable, People would stick it in a blender and then come out with it as a rebranded thing. So it went away. It would have, you know, hardcore was pre and post reaction to it. And then it came back as new wave, and then it went away, and then it came back as, you know, the beats of hip hop. And so, you know, the Beastie Boys and their telling of it, they went away from hardcore because hardcore was too constrictive. It was, it was fun and it was interesting, but it was very ruley, and you had to really stay in your lane. And
it was also, it was also really boring. If you look at the Rollins Band and out in LA, you know, they were rebelling against Orange County, but there's only so many 2-minute guitar songs that you can do before it all sounds the same. And people kind of got tired of the slam dancing. It's had to evolve somewhere. And I think one of the places it started to evolve was New York in 1983, when you saw Madonna break out with an MTV hit. And I mentioned earlier that the Blondie, you know, that was the Rapture video, was the first time that anybody ever did hip hop on MTV was Blondie. You know, she did Fab Five Freddy, you know, and she had maybe 15 seconds, but it was hip hop and it was on MTV. And in 1983, MTV meant that visuals mattered. And I think that helped the Beastie Boys because they were a kind of a clown band. They were dedicated towards shocking people. And they kind of came up in this 83-84 nexus where hardcore mixed with hip hop, and they didn't care what they were doing. They were just playing what they wanted to play. And if they could play hip hop, why not? You know?
Yeah. Well, at that point they had already, I think, started to develop as sound junkies. And so they would follow whatever sounded good to them. And because hip hop was way more expansive than hardcore, hip hop was far more interesting to them.
And it was more urban, right? You're coming out of like Curtis Blow, Grandmaster Flash, Rick James, all that stuff started to emerge in the Rapper's Delight, you know, like that was a big pop hit in 1980. You started to see this blending of these, really an international culture, because that was from Caribbean culture, urban culture. And it all started to mix in the mid 1980s into something that was pretty interesting. And I think the Beastie Boys were in the right place at the right time with meeting Rick Rubin, because he knew Run DMC, right?
Yeah. It's hard to imagine a time where rap albums had not even charted yet.
I mean, not even on MTV. I mean, Michael Jackson.
It's hard to believe that. I mean, you know, the Beastie Boys' License to Ill ends up being the first rap album to go number one, which is unbelievable, because it came out after Raising Hell, which was the biggest, you know, Run DMC was, you know, enormous at that time. And even that album didn't go to number one.
Why don't we back up a little bit? Because I think there was the Sugar Hill Gang, Rapper's Delight, that came out when, you know, 1979, 80, but people didn't really know how to categorize this. You know, it was like, and it was on Top 40 Radio, white Top 40 America, Top 40 Radio. But I think the Beastie Boys, obviously they were exposed to that. And I think they saw some way to be more creative, because hardcore isn't really creative. You're just kind of making noise and for 2 minutes, and then you're kind of drunk and everything, and then that's it. I think hip hop gave them a chance to, you know, give them their personality. And Rick Rubin, he was making records at the NYU dorm, right? Which is a very nice place to be. Rick Rubin is sampling Led Zeppelin and AC/DC into this kind of black hip hop type of music that's starting
Rick Rubin had already started to get his chops in producing. The Beastie Boys came across him because they were making their transition from, you know, hardcore band to the Cookie Puss club single band into wanting to do some rap, and they needed somebody who had the equipment and could DJ. And so that's how they came across Rick Rubin.
And I interrupted you there because I think when they made Cookie Puss, tell us about what Cookie Puss was. It was really just a prank phone call, right? But it caught on. It was kind of funny, right?
It was kind of a foundational element of the Beastie Boys, though at that point they were not a rap band, and Kate Schellenbach, who was in the original band and was the drummer, was still a part of that recording session. But there is an obnoxiousness there's a funny obnoxiousness to the single Cookie Puss, which is like this really fun, catchy club beat and bass line set to a prank call to Caravel ice cream shops to, you know, discuss this novelty cake that they had called Cookie Puss, which was an ice cream cake that was a face, and depending on the season or the holiday, they would just sort of modify the face.
Okay.
And also, Ad Rock was working at an ice cream shop, so I think he had, you know, he had some familiarity with.
Yeah, and he just had some fun. It was a little bit like the Jerky Boys. You know, I don't know if you remember the Jerky Boys, but it was
Yeah.
And so you needed a DJ. So they needed a guy that had the equipment, and Rick Rubin had the turntables in his dorm room, right?
He had the speakers, and apparently he also had a bubble machine. That was very important.
Okay, a bubble machine. And Rick Rubin later went on to become one of the biggest producers of the 80s and 90s.
Not much later. I mean, he really went from his, was a mover and a shaker. He went from, you know, his dorm room is basically the music. He's basically the music version of the start of, you know, Apple computers.
Def Jam, right, with Russell Simmons. Russell Simmons' brother was a key member, Run DMC was.
Yeah, he was Run from Run DMC.
Run DMC. And those guys, Run DMC kind of started this whole thing because they had the look. They got the leather hats and the leather jackets. And that was kind of a break from the Grandmaster Flash, Curtis Blow, Rick James look. They had this kind of look, this attitude, where they had the shoes, the sneakers with no shoelaces, because in jail you could hang yourself with the shoelaces. So they had the attitude, and I think the Beastie Boys really piggybacked on that, right? And Public Enemy as well. We can get to that later, but the Beastie Boys kind of said, "That's kind of cool. How can we do that?" And they did it, you know. And it looks silly in a way, but fortune rewards the bold in a way that they didn't care. They were just like, hey, what the hell? We'll do it, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I'm unsure what allowed them to transgress the line between mimicking and actually becoming their own performers, because so much of their vocal style and actually so much of their music and a lot of their, you know, initial splash at looks is, you know, straight up Run DMC. And yet somehow they were their own band.
But they got along with Run DMC. I mean, they you know, first of all, that's their big breakout is they toured with Madonna. And in 1985, if you tour with Madonna, that's as big as it gets. Madonna in 1985 was like the Beatles in the 80s. She took Michael Jackson's place as the biggest show on earth. So they got that. They didn't even have an album out, but they toured with Madonna.
The sub story of the Madonna tour was, you know, not that they got on the Madonna tour, which was kind of a big deal. It was that the tour promoter wanted to kick them off after they saw them on the first gig, and Madonna insisted that they stay on. So it was almost a one show tour, because they came out, they only had two songs, and their idea was, you know, they state that their best way to be memorable was to be as obnoxious as they could possibly be, because they didn't have a lot else going for them.
And I think they knew Madonna, probably at least were familiar with her from this Danceteria place in the early 80s. And I think Luscious Jackson, they all hung out in those New York places in the early 80s. So they kind of knew that scene. And let's talk about maybe the Beastie Boys were well-connected. What do you know about Adam Horowitz's sister, Rachel Horowitz, for example? You know, this is, she was...
The main thing I know about her is that she was living in Los Angeles, and after the License to Ill success and explosion and then subsequent implosion, that it allowed Ad Rock to, you know, have a reason to go somewhere else. And so he went and his sister was there for a brief time. He showed up, she introduced him to a couple of people, and, you know, that started the foundational element for Paul's Boutique. But I actually know little else about her.
Well, she's a really interesting case because, she's the daughter. Their father was a very pretty well-known playwright in New York and everything. And I always heard the story. She went to Paris and their family friend, Samuel Beckett, the guy who wrote Waiting for Godot.
Yeah, that's amazing family friend.
Everybody needs a family friend like that. And recommended that she works at a Shakespeare and Company in the Left Bank, this famous bookstore in Paris. And so she later went on to make films. Some of the best ones that she was associated with are some of my favorites. Rushmore, Blue Velvet.
I was unaware of
Moneyball. She did Moneyball, and so what I'm getting at here is they were connected. They weren't just three kids from Brooklyn or three kids from New York. They were connected, but that's how life works. So they go on the tour with Madonna, but their real breakout, I think, in the whole genre was when Run DMC makes this record with Aerosmith, and it's called Walk This Way. What do you remember about that video? You were just probably a kid, but do you remember how big that was? That was a huge
crossover. it was monstrous. And what I didn't realize at the time was how I had missed how big Aerosmith was.
You were too young.
Part of what's funny about that story is in Ad Rock's retelling, you know, he said, let's be real, nobody was talking about Aerosmith when that record got made. Aerosmith was not at the height of their popularity. They, you know, subsequently ended up having a couple of monster runs after that, but they were known as a 70s band,
They were dead when that thing came out, you know, and but the video, if you haven't seen it, it's kind of a mashup really of 70s rock that was kind of dead in 1986, and this new thing coming up, and they did, you know, and they did a great job of this video.
And Run DMC and Rick Rubin really reintroduced that. I think Run DMC possibly before Rick Rubin's rock influence at first, and then together through, you know, that song was the hottest song in the land. It made everything explode.
The summer of 1986, that song's charting in the top five. And that really paves the way for the Beastie Boys, because they're kind of a crossover band. They're really hardcore and they're kind of hip hop, but not really. Nobody really knows what they are. But they come out on that the Run DMC tour, right?
And they're their music is cop Led Zeppelin riffs, and they have some original music on there as well. But it is definitely, you know, a spare hard rock sound in a lot of their looping,
and they're intentionally raunchy. I say this because the mid-1980s, we have the risky business culture, the Ferris Bueller's Day Off culture. It's kind of like the 1980s, unless you were there, you wouldn't understand it, but it was kind of like a bad, you know, fraternity boy kind of culture. The New York Mets had just won the World Series, and they had this sort of machismo about it, but kind of a juvenile machismo.
Those Mets were a handful.
Yeah, and I hated those teams, you know, and I still remember, Bill Buckner to this day, right? And Calvin Schiraldi, but that's another story. But they came out in late 86 with this License to Ill, right?
They came out with License to Ill, and you talk about their relationship with Run DMC, and Run DMC really, you know, I would say they were friends as much as you could be friends with an idol. You know, they idolized Run DMC, and at no point did they put themselves in the same sort of class as Run DMC. They were just happy to be there, but also, you know, the way they describe it is that, when you're hanging out with those guys and you're coming up with songs together, if you're playing basketball with LeBron James and LeBron James passes you the ball, you better drive the lane.
Yeah. So, and they had confidence, and they knew they had to do this. I mean, they had bravado. They wore sunglasses. Let's face it, they dressed like pimps. You know, they were like suburban New York kids that were doing, they're stealing the VW medallions, you know, they were playing the game.
Absolutely. And it, going back to basketball, reminds me of, you know, there's like a discussion about Caucasian point guards, and, you know, sometimes people come up as being like a Bobby Hurley type. And I remember hearing, a counterpoint. Somebody said, yeah, but Bobby Hurley could score. And so, and the Beastie Boys, you know, you there's no telling who can score. And the thing is that they could score regardless of their other circumstances. Like they made awesome music that sounded good and was popular.
And it came out, I mean, everybody of a certain age remembers this because it's the spring of 87. They go on Joan Rivers, if you can, you can YouTube this, where they're intentionally obnoxious, right? They got the sunglasses, they got the hats, they got the medallions. They're intentionally overkilling it. But they have a single that hits on MTV and it hits big. And it's called You Got the Right to Party. And it wasn't really a hip song. It was kind of a rock song in a way, you know?
It was definitely, yeah, it was definitely a rock song. I think it was getting some radio play slash, you know, starting to chart already. And they had to like rush to get the video on MTV because that was the thing that would really cause you to explode. And it's a wonderful half tongue in cheek video that involves drunkenness and pie fights. Was really an interesting mix of really a good representation of their personality, where you really could not tell, you know, now they say a lot of it was done in irony, but you know, if you use a pickup line on somebody and they take it, is that really ironic? It's not ironic.
And you can see that's in the kind of post Revenge of the Nerds, you know, the Poindexters, you know, the nerds are having oh, we hope no bad people come. And the bad people are kind of these guys who are just ruin the party. But it's a bravado, a false bravado, maybe, but it worked for them. And that song hit top 40 radio. And I still remember it. It was the same time as like U2's Joshua Tree, you know. So you have this this idea where they broke through top 40 radio before anybody did, and nobody knew what to make of these.
Oh, guys. And it was, you're right about the Sex Pistols, which is my initial reaction to hearing that. I remember the first time that I heard, Fight for Your Right to Party, and it was like on a local radio station that was running like a Keep It or Trash It. So they would play this, play a song one time, and then they would commit to whether they would continue to play it or whether you'd never play it again. And I went to the payphone in front of my high school because I had been listening to that station on a Walkman. And I went to the payphone. I was so upset by what a terrible, terrible song it was that I actually went to the payphone in my high school to call the radio station to say it was the stupidest, dumbest, they should definitely trash it.
Yeah. And it was a stupid song, but it was catchy. And they knew it was catchy. They knew the video was catchy. It was a time of that, kind of a transition into another era. And they were the same time as, you know, the culture was changing a little bit. Like they were the same record label as Public Enemy, right? And LL Cool J, you know, they were Def Jam. They were on that label, right? With Ruben.
Yeah, and actually, I think the Beastie Boys were you know, possibly around when LL Cool J was recording his first thing, because they were sort of, you know, music studio junkies. So a lot of the earlier radio hits that ended up coming out of that Def Jam era, the Beastie Boys, even before they had charted, were actually in the studio for hanging around.
Yeah. So that makes them huge. They go to Europe, they go to England especially. And I think the whole, you know, those guys must have been exposed to the whole Sex Pistols thing. You know, Sid and Nancy, that film came out in the late 80s. They were New York kids. They knew that the Sex Pistols got attention from just being bad. And they went to England, and you know, DJ Hurricane tells this story about how the tabloids in Britain just wanted to, they were waiting for them like they were 10 years after the Sex Pistols. Do you know anything?
Oh,
about
yeah.
That?
Yeah. 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 I think the headline, you know, it's the tabloids, and they were, I think they were unfamiliar. I'm not sure if New York tabloids were more based in fact, but I think they were unfamiliar with the concept that even though they actually had legitimate antics, that in England, the tabloids would just make something up about you.
Like, yeah.
So, they would, so I think the headline was, you know, bad boy band insults cripple kid. I think it was something that. Yeah. I mean, it was you know, literally the worst that they could do. So when they showed up thinking that they were, you know, bad boys, what England had in store for them was that they were even worse than they actually were.
So
they go on this tour through England, and each place that they go to, this reputation that actually is far beyond who they are precedes them. So every place that, you know, through the tour, like each city they go to, the next city is expecting, you know, an even, you know, even bigger obnoxious, you know, riot. And so it culminates in the end where they can't even finish their gig. You know, they run off stage and go hide back at the hotel. And it turns out that, you know, somebody got injured by a flying a full beer can. And, you know, the cops come to, you know, basically arrest the Beastie Boys for assault.
And that was the peak of their obnoxiousness, right? I mean, that was their gig. They're white guys from New York who are, you know, trying to be a hip hop band, but they're succeeding at it. But there's nowhere really to go after that. In a way, because they had a one-hit wonder. It's hard to remember how big that song was. It was on the radio all the time. So they have to do a follow-up, and they have a falling out with Rick Rubin and Russell Simmons from Def Jam, right? What was the problem with that?
The problem was that Rick Rubin, who was you know, had advanced as a producer and part label owner, apparently decided that he was doing a lot of the work. And so there was a telling conversation, apparently, when they were discussing, you know, at the height of their popularity, they were going to make a movie called Scared Stupid, which was going to be like a sort of a drunken Abbott and Costello haunted house thing. And at some point, Rick Rubin tells them casually that, you know, they'll make, the Beastie Boys will make 10% of the profit, and Rick Rubin and Russell Simmons will make 90% of the profit because they're the ones doing all the work. Yeah. And so that was sort of a telling moment for them. They ended up not getting any more money from License to Ill. It's an age old story of typical record contract label shenanigans, but you're right. It coincided with what had happened with a year of touring and, you know, drunken shenanigans and being on a wave that maybe they couldn't surf anymore. And Ad Rock describes, you know, what happened in License to Ill and the ugliness of the disconnect from the crowd and the antics as being like, you know, like a pimple that just kept going until the pimple was the entire person. And at some point it was going to pop.
Yeah, and that's be real. It was a pretty obnoxious band, and they had an obnoxious tour. They had there was a lot of, you know, sort of debauchery involved in that. And I don't think those guys wanted to stay that way, and they were looking for a way out, and they found it in Los Angeles, right? What do we know about?
I don't think it was a break on purpose, but they all needed to recover, and they all went their separate ways.
And you already referenced that Ad Rock's sister was out there working in Hollywood, so they had a place to stay, and they had a place to stay.
Ad Rock's mother apparently passed away at about that time, and you know, he said he needed to get away. So he went out to Los Angeles and auditioned for a role in this movie Lost Angels, and filmed in Texas for a little bit, but he ended up meeting, you know, a new group of friends outside of, you know, his New York scene.
And what year are we talking about? Early 88, something like that? You know,
yeah. We're talking late 87, early 88.
Yeah. And there's a new scene going out in Los Angeles. There's Tone Loke, Young MC, there's a sort of this, the Run DMC kind of hook kind of went out west, and there's the culture is changing, and they kind of got in on this. How did they meet this connection, the Dust Brothers, and this idea of New York art scene connecting with the LA DJ scene? Do you know anything about that? Like 1988?
Yeah, well, I think Ad Rock was taking a break from making music, but he was still a music junkie. And so he was at a party in Los Angeles, and Matt Dyke was there, who was a club owner from License to Ill days, where actually the Beastie Boys had played his club, and because of the type of music that they had as a background, which was very bass heavy, which apparently the club systems in Los Angeles were not made for it. You know, they got about a song and a half in and broke the audio system at Matt Dyke's club, where I think the club is called Power Tools.
Yeah.
So, and that ends up, you know, coming into play with with how they end up connecting back with Matt Dyke. Matt Dyke's hanging out with a couple of guys that are doing this new computer-based sampling that allows you to layer many, many things on top of each other. And instead of this rock sound, they're doing a lot of funkier things, a lot of different little samples. And so Ed Rock's at a party and he meets Matt Dyke, or he gets reacquainted with him, and Matt Dyke is playing these incredibly smooth tracks.
And Matt Dyke's in LA, and this is important because Ad Rock's sister is out there, and Matt Dyke is kind of the transplant from the New York art scene, right? And he knows Andy Warhol, he knows Fab Five Freddy, he knows all those guys, and they're staying at his house in LA. So there's a cross-pollination of LA and New York, which didn't necessarily have to happen, it just did. And they met Mario C, and they were producing Tone Loc and Young MC, right? These two pop hip hop songs that were huge in, I'm guessing, 88, 89, Tone Loc with Wild Thing and Young MC with Bust a Move. And that was the Dust Brothers, right? That was this connection.
Yeah, which were, you know, written, recorded, produced in Matt Dyke's, you know, living room of his apartment / recording studio. So Matt Dyke had owned this club called Power Tools, or he was part of the one of the owners. The Beastie Boys show up a couple years earlier, break the sound system. And when the sound system breaks that night, Mario C, who ends up being the Beastie Boys engineer, track down the club owner and says, you know, your sound system's ridiculous. I've got a better sound system. I'll bring it in here. And so that's how they got acquainted. And then, you know, shortly after that, the club closes and the two of them, you know, basically make a recording studio in Matt Dyke's living room where, you know, Tone Loc and, the other songs you discussed were, you know, engineered.
And those were the first that in addition to Run DMC and Aerosmith, that was the crossover. Tone Loc and Young MC Bust a Move. They were top 40 radio hits. That's the first time hip hop got on kind of top 40 radio on MTV. And the Beastie Boys were kind of in the middle of that because Matt Dyke said, hey, I want to make their record, because they had fallen out with Def Jam. They were suing Rick Rubin, right? And Russell Simmons. They wanted out of Def Jam, their contract. They sign with Capitol. They go out to LA and they find these guys, the Dust Brothers, who have this groovy kind of sound that even Mario C says, we didn't even know how these guys did this, you know, like they knew, and nobody had ever heard of the term sample before. And even the DJ term was kind of new. But what do you know about the Dust Brothers? What made them so special, where the Beastie Boys were attracted to them?
You know, I think the sound that they had was so layered and different that it, you know, in Ad Rock's describing, I'll paraphrase, but it basically, you know, brought them back from the dead in terms of wanting to, you know, get back into making music. So we hear, you know, the tracks are so layered and stunning that, you know, he calls MCA and Mike D and they're, you know, wherever they are at that point, because they're not in the West Coast. It says, you got to, you know, come out and listen to this stuff. And I think we should all make music together.
And they did make music, and it was the Beastie Boys famously, they started out as a hardcore punk band. They played their music, you know, and they played their instruments probably not perfectly in the early 80s. And then they had the big top 40 hit, but then they said, hey, we can rhyme to this, you know, like this is stuff that we can lay over our rhymes and we can do it and we can be funny and we can be creative. And Paul's Boutique was a work of genius. And that's the first thing you told me when I met you. You said, listen to this. But it, you know, let's talk about how they made this album. It was they didn't play any instruments, right? They were just doing their vocals over this Dust Brothers.
What is that track that you really like from it? Is it Looking Down the Barrel of a Gun?
I love that song. I think it's perfect.
Okay,
song.
I think maybe that's the only song that I know that they might maybe have played instruments on.
Okay, so. but they had all of these, you know, the Dust Brothers, they rent out a studio. Where is the studio? It's in Los Angeles.
Well, they apparently made a lot / most of the album in Matt Dyke's apartment. And okay. They did the sequencing. They did the sampling, and they had just an enormous amount of different pieces of music that were, you know, as Frank Zappa would call the process, you know, they were composing. Yes, they were samples, but they were composing these bits into.
And yep. And that's, you know, in 1988, nobody remembered, you know, the music from the 70s, and they brought it back, right? I mean, they're doing from Curtis Mayfield's Superfly, they're doing
they
Slide.
Did. And, even though, you know, the Tone Loc song, you know, was a cop from Van Halen's Jamie's Crying, and Led Zeppelin was definitely, you know, sampled, you know, looped, as they would call it, looped for License to Ill. Those were all like, you know, long bars and sort of single layers. And yeah. Paul's Boutique, the tracks behind it, were many, many, many different samples, a lot from a lot of esoteric groups that were, you know, in the 70s that were, you know, some were top 40, some were not top 40. And they were all, you know, pieced together with, you know, sort of an enormous amount of layering, but and also a lot of composition and a lot of pop culture without the lyrics that were really representative in there, you know, 15, 20 years of music.
Yeah. And there's esoteric stuff from New York City and just the funk soul culture of the 70s. There's a lot of James Brown in there. There's Rolls Royce, you know, like the kind of pop culture stuff that I grew up with on the radio, but they knew how to pick it. And I think the Dust Brothers and the Beastie Boys were a perfect mix of that 70s meeting the 80s, moving into the 90s. So they just got it. And I think if you listen to that record, and I had to listen to it a lot, you know, before I understood it, it's really a work of genius how they put all that stuff together. And they sampled how many songs? 300 or something, or 150 or something.
It was incredible, you know, and it's sort of like nebulous how many samples they cleared. And, you know, it's widely recognized as sort of the beginning and end of an era of doing that because of the cost was enormous shortly after that. I mean, at the time, nobody was really doing it. And so there wasn't really a cost associated with it. But once people figured out that, you know, they could get money for the licensing, or that they should get money for the licensing is a better way to put it, then the idea that you would have, you know, a couple hundred different people you'd have to pay out just to make your album went away. And in a lot of ways, it's like Sgt. Pepper in how it's layered, but it's also a lot of ways like Sgt. Pepper in that, like, once you made Sgt. Pepper, any album that was ever made that sounded like that was just going to be evocative of Sgt. Pepper. And so nobody ever really, you know, there wasn't a lot of other Sgt. Peppers to come after that because it was sort of an outlier high watermark. And so there was not another Paul's Boutique. There was only Paul's Boutique.
Even the Beatles after Sgt. Pepper's, they made the White Album, right? It was very simplistic. They went say, we can't do this anymore. And I think Paul's Boutique is important because, it changed their attitude towards life. We're getting into the late 80s. But I think the Beastie Boys were the first people in the late 1980s to revive this sort of ironic respect for the 70s. Because if you remember in the 80s, the 70s were ridiculed, right? People like you had Spinal Tap, all of that stuff was just, it was embarrassing. Yeah. And the Beastie Boys said, hey, man, 70s were pretty cool, you know, like Superfly is a great film. Go back and check it out. You know, the whole idea of the 70s was revived on that album, and they even dressed like it, right, in those videos.
They dressed like it. They lived in a 70s place. They, you know, lived a 70s lifestyle. They got big cars and drove around. And I think that they, you know, they thought that Paul's Boutique was going to be as successful as License to Ill because they didn't know any better. They'd only made one album. It had sold 12 million copies. Wow. And so, you know, in the book, they keep referencing themselves at that point as being the multi-platinum License to Ill people. And so they go to Capitol Records and Capitol, you know, there's a story in the book where Tower Records, which is a record store in a big record store at the time on the West Coast, is just down the street from the Capitol Records building. And, you know, about a week after Paul's Boutique is released, you know, they go into the record store looking for Paul's Boutique, and it's not even there. And they're like, oh, this is a great sign. Like, it's all sold out already, you know, thinking that it's all, you know, flying off the shelves. But really, there was only a few albums there. They had all sold out and had never gotten restocked. And so when they went to Capitol Records, you know, they got a meeting with the new president, who explained to them, you know, hey, listen, you guys, you're going to have to wait till next time, is what he told them. He said, we got a Donny Osmond album we're promoting. So on your next album, you know, we'll, you know, consider doing some work on it. And so they were surprised.
Well, I think that was released in July of 1989, and it came out, the single was Hey Ladies, which was an ironic song because they're all dressed as like 70s guys. And at that time, it wasn't quite cool yet. They had a couple singles that were made into the videos, but the album went nowhere. They didn't even tour on it, right?
I mean, no. The album, I mean, it went to number 14, but it didn't stay for very long. I remember that. I certainly didn't understand it for, you know, many months, but ended up being, you know, a proselytizer of it after it sunk in how amazing. I mean, I loved all the samples, and I, you know, loved their rhymes, and their pop culture references were all amazing. But really, the base layer is that with the Dust Brothers doing the music and the way that they rode the wave of the music with the rhymes, it just sounded great.
It was fantastic.
Yeah,
it's one of the best albums you could ever listen to on a headphones.
Listen to it over and over and over, and it was so fun and funny and driving. It was spectacular, and you know that it's kind of like, you know, maybe like Dark Side of the Moon, in that, you know, it just kept on going, even though you didn't know what the single would be.
You gave me that tape. It was back in the days of tapes and cassette tape, and I remember listening to that. There's so much information on there that's packed in there. There's a lot of sports references, a lot of pop culture references. But I remember the one line where they said, my favorite New York Knick was Hawthorne Wingo. And my father, growing up, I used to watch a lot of basketball. I'd watch the Lakers. And when the Lakers would play the Knicks, I grew up in Bakersfield, California. And my father, when he heard the name Hawthorne Wingo, he says, that name is beautiful. You know, he'd be smoking a cigar. He goes, Hawthorne Wingo. And when the Beastie Boys referenced him, it, for me, it was like taking me back to my childhood. Rod Carew, Sadahara O, Fred Flintstone, the Brady Bunch, but mixed in with a lot of like urban kind of 70s, the Curtis Mayfield Superfly stuff, you know? So they really had a wealth of information that they put on there that it's hard to explain to people now how important that was.
Yeah. I mean, it was like, you know, it was like an inside joke that you could get that made you wonder, like, how deep does this thing go?
Yeah. Sam the Butcher bringing Alice the Meat, right? You would have to, you know, that's like Brady Bunch stuff. And it's, you know, and they're kind of having fun doing it, but the album goes nowhere, at least initially. Everybody likes it now, but it went nowhere. It made no money. You know,
it went nowhere. They spent a huge, so they made, you know, they made the album basically three times apparently, right? So they made it in Matt Dyke's living room.
Yeah.
And then they, you know, they said that inexplicably they go rent a huge studio space that they fill with like video games and air hockey table, and they try to then re-record all the tracks, you know, including the sampling and the sequencing and the lyrics, and then they realize that it was better in Matt Dyke's living room. So then they go to another expensive recording studio, which apparently didn't work at all. It was like the latest state of the art of the future, and I think Mike D said, you know, unfortunately at that time the future sucked, and so. And so then they go back to, I think the record plant is the recording studio, and they try to re-record Paul's Boutique and finish it again. And so they waste an enormous amount of money, which ends up sort of informing what, you know, their future recording process. And what's amazing to me is that they were able to keep their record contract at this point, because you would think that they would have gotten dumped after, you know, not making Fight for Your Right to Party 2, making something that's so esoteric that doesn't chart. But they said at that time there was a lot of turnover at Capitol Records, and that they were treated like a dead pigeon in the schoolyard, that nobody wanted to touch it.
But, you know, Ira, I think the Beastie Boys, one of the things that allowed them to write a memoir, you know, in after 30 years in the business, is they were always one step ahead of what's becoming cool. And I think after Paul's Boutique, they kind of relaxed a little bit. They didn't worry that it didn't sell, but they got into their own lives in Los Angeles, right? They kind of settled in there. Ad Rock became
they settled in, and they settled in, and they took what they had, you know, learned as stinging lessons from Paul's Boutique, you know, which, you know, at the time was a commercial, not unsuccessful, but of course now we're discussing it still 20 some years later, 30 years later. And they took those lessons and went back to sort of a punk do-it-yourself aesthetic, which is, they said they realized they wouldn't be able to sample it. You know, they'd taken sampling as far as it could go, and that actually was too expensive, but it had already been done. And they decided that they would go back to where they started, and they would play their instruments, except that now they had been influenced by all of this music the Dust Brothers had put onto them. And so what they wanted to do was play instruments like they were from the 70s rather than, you know, hardcore.
And they kind of, you know, one of the things about the Beastie Boys that I always thought that played in their favor is they didn't care. They were said, hey, man, we're going to do what we want. And in ordinary life, that's kind of obnoxious, but let's be realistic, you know, that if you don't care, things break your way. And I think after Paul's Boutique, they didn't care. They stayed out in L.A. Ad Rock gets married to Donovan's daughter, right? Iona Sky, he becomes an actor. They kind of settle down. MCA gets into the Buddhist movement a little bit. They kind of become men. They're not the children they were in the early 80s, right? You know,
yeah, well, they, you know, they made their way, right? So they had whatever breaks they had, they were a huge success, and then they were, you know, people were tired of that taste, is the best way I could put it. And they moved from coast to coast. They, you know, they do this great album that it's not a flop, but it's just not a commercial success, and they don't run away with their tails between their legs and run back to New York City or go back and make Fight for Your Right to Party 3. Like they go on and do like basically a third genre of music and three albums.
And the culture is changing. And in 89, they make Paul's Boutique. People didn't care about it at the time. I think probably they didn't understand it. It's a hard album to understand, really. There's a lot of information in that album. It's not a pop album. There's no single off of that.
And, there's no single. And the other portion is that in terms of what they were presenting pop culturally before, there's not a lot you can mimic, right? So, you know, in Fight for Your Right to Party, like I put on the baseball cap backwards, like I could totally follow that aesthetic. Yeah, but when Paul's Boutique came out, what was there to mimic?
You were sort there's of a lot of stuff in there, though. I'm Just Chilling, Like Bob Dylan. There's a lot of stuff in there that is not for the Fight for Your Right to Party crowd. You know, there's a lot of really esoteria in there. So in 89 and 90, the culture starts to change. You start to get this emergence of Nirvana and grunge. And I think the Beastie Boys went along with that. And they said, we got to do something different. They had Mario C. They stay in LA. And they said, we got to play our own instruments. And what do you know about Check Your Head? You know, this.
Check Your Head, they decided that instead of, you know, renting these recording studios where they would have to take everything down and put it back up and take it down. You know, they were admittedly, you know, they described themselves as sort of lazy in their process, and that they like to go play whatever idea they came up with. And then after that idea was done, they'd like to leave their instruments where they were and go smoke some pot and eat some snacks and listen to some music. And so, you know, instead of having a rented recording studio, they rented it sort of like on a permanent basis, rebuilt a studio so that they could leave their instruments up and available all the time. And I'll say, you know, according to them, as importantly, they built a skate ramp and a, you know, a basketball court into it so that they could basically hang out and play jams. And, you know, they had many, 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 many hours of recorded music for Check Your Head as they became, you know, I would say competent or fluid in their instruments.
You know, I know a lot of you know, I'm a teacher, and I deal with the young people a lot, and I'm always conflicted in this idea of perpetual adolescence or becoming an adult. And I think the Beastie Boys are a good example of that. You can kind of do both in a way. You know, you don't have to be boring when you turn 30. And they were about turning 30 there. They just said, hey, let's smoke some pot and make great, great art. And they made Check Your Head, which was a departure from Paul's Boutique. And it was a departure from Ill Communication, or I mean, License to Ill.
Yeah. In today's sort of business parlance, you could say that what they created was they had a cultural music incubator that they created. They still had, you know, a small set of friends that they would do these activities with, but it branched out culturally to be the music, the look.
Yeah. And they had the look in 1992. Check Your Head was different. It was different than Nirvana. Nirvana came out, you know, in 91 with the breakout, you know, Smells Like Teen Spirit. There was the grunge angle out of Seattle. The Beastie Boys did something different. It was something different, but it was something in between. It was a little bit only they could do this. And Check Your Head, I think, is aged really well. And Mario C was the engineer on that, but he was also he tells the story. They just went, smoked a lot of pot, ate a lot of pizza, you know, and just recorded music. And we just went back to the basics, and it took us 3 years to do it.
Yeah.
But we just did it. And the result is pretty good.
It's pretty incredible. It's like, you know, another, you know, for me, it appeared like another overnight success, right? That came out about a month afterwards. I realized I actually liked it. And about a month after that, like I'm dressing in the clothes that they're dressing, not understanding really that, you know, like you said, they're on the forefront. This is like 3 years in the making, right? You just see it when it comes out of the oven. But there's so much that's gone into it prior to that.
And I'm about these guys' age exactly. So I understand their cultural references. But when they did the Whatcha Want video, you showed me that, I think, somehow. You told me about it. Maybe we were in Alaska.
No, so I had it on videotape, but yeah.
Okay. But, you know, that was even kind of revolutionary, how they get inside the camera and they do that thing. It's probably on top of a record store somewhere where they're just like, it looks like, and they incorporate the skater culture, which is starting to come in the early 90s. You know, that whole idea of skateboards, smoking pot, you know, and that album is, you know, today I can play it. There's a cafe down the corner from my house called Jalona Me, and I can play the music and I can play Beastie Boys and people understand it. Like people say, hey, man, that's still relevant, you know? And,
yeah, it is. It's relevant. I mean, really at the core, we're talking about them as in their processes and them as icons and them and how much they charted or didn't chart. But really at the core is that their albums sound terrific. It's the music that really, we wouldn't be talking about them if the music wasn't good. It's just really interesting that the music is so terrific and their story is so interesting.
So the culture is changing. They do Check Your Head and they go on tour and they realize they like playing their own instruments and they get back to that. And they're not perfect at their instruments and they admit that, but they had some help. They had Money Mike. Is that right? You know, this guy?
Keyboard Money Mike.
Yeah. Yeah. And he kind of walks them through this. And then we don't have to be great musicians. We don't claim to be. But then they come back and they make the album with this, probably their signature hit of their career, Sabotage. You know,
that had it all. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And what do you know about this Ill Communication, you know, like,
Ill Communication was a continuation of Check Your Head. So they had such a great time. Check Your Head, I think, went to number 10 or 11. So it was better than number 14, but it was in terms of its cultural influence when that came out, that was basically the expression of what the lives that we were living at that time or wanted to live was. And so it really was a sort of a cultural, like, hallmark moment of being represented, which is, you know, pretty unbelievable and really what people pine for in terms of their musical influences. So that came out and they were so important and doing so well that they just continued on and made Ill Communication, which was really like Check Your Head 2, continuing to play their instruments. And, you know, they, Sabotage, I think the way that it came about was that Adam Yauch was playing this bass line and they all came in and they were like, oh, that's a cool bass line. Like, you know, who wrote that? And he's like, it's ours. We're doing this yeah. song now. So
yeah.
It apparently stayed an instrumental for a long time until they were able to come up with something and put some lyrics to it.
And they had Spike Jonze doing the video. That video was really important because I think, as I said before, they were always one step ahead of what was hip in the culture. And that was, you know, the 70s, you know, it was a kitsch cop show. You know, they're making fun of those 70s cop shows. And but Spike Jonze did a good job on that because they made it kind of funny. You know, like it was Beretta and Starsky and Hutch and that kind of stuff. And that was the same year that Dazed and Confused came out, you know, the 70s film. And they were always ahead of their, just one step ahead, and then they never repeated themselves. And I think that's really important. But Sabotage, let's talk about that single. You can hear that now in a bar, and everybody knows that.
It's incredible. You know, they showed up on the Letterman show, and now you're talking almost a decade after License to Ill. These guys that were like, you know, thought by some to be manufactured one hit wonders show up on the Letterman show playing their own instruments, just, you know, ripping an incredible original song, you know.
And this is about the time we can get personal now. You saw them, what's the first time you saw the Beastie Boys? You saw them in 87?
Yeah. First time I saw them was 87 when they were touring with Run DMC. And you know, I would say out of the times that I have seen them, I remember very little about the music, because each time I went to see them, they were like a cultural event that was happening, and the music was part of it, but it was literally just like a confluence and a gathering. So
And you saw them on did you see them on the Check Your Head tour?
I saw them on Check Your Head, where they had a few, as you alluded to, they didn't really tour Paul's Boutique. So they had a few Paul's Boutique things. So they were mixing in between, you know, doing this like DJ stuff and playing their own instruments. And then I saw them around the, you know, in between Ill Communication and Hello Nasty. I saw them in New York. And that was like it was a huge venue, and it was still like a who's who. Everywhere you looked around, there were just famous New Yorkers of our generation that were like at the show among you. You know, I remember walking in to the venue past Sean Lennon, you know, who was just standing at the doorway waiting to go in.
Who's Sean Lennon? Just to, in case our viewers don't know, you know, like
Sean Lennon is the son of John Lennon and Yoko Ono.
Yeah. And he's actually quite
a musician and producer. Yep.
And he's actually on the same label as the Beastie Boys, but he says they are the closest thing to the Beatles he's ever seen. I've heard him say that.
I'm unaware. It was just a sort of a memorable moment because it's a very New York moment. Like you alluded to, in the 70s, part of the New York music scene is that New York, everything's really accessible because you have to be on the street to get into a place. And so walking by Sean Lennon was extraordinary and normal at the same time.
And I think this is a good time to talk about that, because people now say, and I see this all the time, that Paul's Boutique is the Sgt. Pepper's of hip hop, right? Have you heard that term? And Sean Lennon... Yes.
Yeah.
Sean Lennon might have even been the author of that term.
Yeah.
But Public Enemy toured with the Beastie Boys, and they support them. They said that we learned as much from the Beastie Boys as they learned from us. And it's actually a mutual admiration society. So I think this controversy about the Beastie Boys as being kind of privileged is accurate, but they also made the most of that opportunity. And I don't think a lot of people do that in life, you know, when you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the talent and the rewards that come from the talent are real, I would say, in terms of their history and being privileged, probably the biggest privilege that they had was, even if they had failed to make it as musicians, they probably were going to be okay, which a lot of the urban musical acts that, you know, were without that sort of privilege or the middle class support had, you know, it's very similar to sports, right? There's only a couple ways out of your condition in those circumstances.
Yeah. And they toured with Cypress Hill. They toured with Run DMC. They toured with Public Enemy. So in a way, they were kind of a bridge into this culture that we have now. Do you think that's true?
Yeah. I do. Yeah. I mean, I think that they were, they were emissaries that could move in between things. And at no point did they get stuck as pigeonholed as either the white rap band or the punk band or the disco band or the grunge band. They were able to really move between all these things because they were, they were music junkies that were, and as you, it's taken a long time for me to realize how great of musicians that they are, because I was also thrown off by, at first they didn't play their own instruments when they had a hit record and then they played it, but they were sort of mimicking a jazz thing. But then I realized that I actually love that music aside from who made it. And that they're able to play so many different genres really speaks to their, how their musicianship and how good they sound.
And then 10 years after making this really absurd video, You Got the Right to Party, they actually got into international cultural events where they were really into the Tibet thing, especially MCA, right? And Free Tibet from China. And that became kind of their cause in the 90s. That it was like the social cause of, they became something more than just a hip hop band.
Yeah, I think for MCA, it was sort of the transition from the DIY, from the do-it-yourself movement into something that was probably broader in terms of assisting, I would say culture in general. And so, for that generation, it was really the first that I had heard of it. And I didn't really actually even understand what was going on. Just this concept of, when I heard about it, I was thinking like, what's the gimmick here? Yeah. I hadn't really considered that these people were transforming themselves and becoming, as we all are, concerned for things outside of ourselves.
I think the 90s was the part of this, what they call now the woke culture. That's a term that's, flexible. People like it or don't like it. But I think in the 90s, they were completely different than the materialistic 80s. Even Madonna, her big song in the 80s was Material Girl, and now she hates that song. And I think the Beastie Boys hate their initial song in the 80s. And they, nobody wants to be a materialistic pig. And in the 90s, people started saying, hey, there's something bigger than ourselves. And maybe we can help and do something about it. And I think that they did it pretty tastefully. They were not obnoxious about it. I think they were sincere about it.
Yeah, and I think it also outlines that they were able to each continue to do their own things as individuals.
Yeah.
And yet they stayed a band. There wasn't a falling out. There weren't solo albums. Yeah. There weren't other relationships that fractured the band or egos that made it split up. I mean, they were a band to the end. And when MCA passed, the other two Beastie Boys said, there is no more Beastie Boys because there's three of us and now there's only two.
And there's where we get into this, because if you're, the Rolling Stones are still touring, they're an aberration there. But when you reach middle age, it's hard to be a hip hop band. You have to kind of change your style a little bit. And moving out of the 1990s into the 21st century, I remember I visited you in New York in 2000 and or 2001. I remember I stayed at your house in New York, and you were living in New York. Why? Why did you move to New York? Do you remember that time?
I moved to New York because I wanted to enjoy the excitement of New York, but also I thought perhaps I could, be a stand-up comic there. So
yeah. How was your stand-up comic career? What was the hardest thing about being a stand-up comic? And then we'll get back to the Beastie Boys.
The hardest thing about being a stand-up comic?
You told me a story one day about how the Simpsons ruined everything about stand-up comedy. Do you remember telling me that?
No, I didn't. But it was probably because they could comment on so many observations in such a compressed manner on a weekly basis that you were left looking under rocks for crumbs of things that were funny that other people hadn't noted already.
But you were a really funny guy. And what was your most memorable moment in stand-up comedy in New York? That's a hard place. That's Lenny Bruce area. That's Richard Pryor.
I showed up in New York and I was so overwhelmed by the New York experience. Like, I just got a job and had fun, and stand-up comedy went by the wayside.
Okay, but did you have any success as a stand-up comedian?
Not in New York.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I saw my biggest success for stand-up comedy in New York was being a fan at the comedy clubs and getting to see a lot of great stand-up.
Okay, it's very modest of you because you're a very funny guy. I remember listening to your stories, cutting fish in Alaska, and you made me laugh, 10 times a day, which is rare.
Oh, that's nice.
I did see you in June of 2001. I had flown back from Poland. I was on a Fulbright in Poland, and we stayed at your house in Brooklyn, which used to be a Polish neighborhood. And I still remember seeing the same newspaper in the Warsaw airport as I did in your neighborhood 7 hours later. And we went out and got some beers and we played some billiards. And then I said, I'm coming back in September to fly out. And my flight was September 14th, 2001.
That's crazy.
And, I remember watching you play basketball the Twin Towers were there in June of 2001. And
you came to one of my games?
I came to one of your games. You don't remember?
No, really?
Yeah,
I can't believe I really must have had, I must have had a lot of nerve to have you come watch me play basketball.
I loved it. I was with Julia and you were playing against the Russian mafia from Brighton.
Oh, talk about going full circle from me asking if I should look at the ball when I shoot. How's that?
And you were good. I remember. I loved it. But anyway, that was a great night. We went out and had beers after that. And I went to a conference, the Piazza, the Polish Institute of Arts and Sciences.
You're making me miss those times, Pat.
Oh, it was a great summer. But I came back September 17th, 2001. And you were actually down there in the Twin Towers when everything happened. You want to tell that story? I mean, you were working where? You were working at? At a bookstore,
I was working at the corporate headquarters for Barnes & Noble College Bookstores. It was in this fabulous building on Union Square. There were, a couple streets from Union Square that gave you a straight shot of the towers downtown. I came out of the subway that Tuesday morning thinking about Monday Night Football. And, there was something going on in the street where everybody was facing the same direction, but which happens sometimes in New York. But everybody was kind of looking up instead of, on the street level. And one of the towers had already been hit by a plane. And while we were, looking down the street, the other tower got hit. So I wasn't next to the towers. I was probably two and a half miles away, but it was close enough.
Could you see it from your window?
Yeah. After the second tower got hit, I went up to, work, and we all were looking out the window, and we just silent until those towers fell.
Could you hear them fall? Well, I mean, or was it too far away?
It was really the sound. The sound when the towers fell was the sound of people gasping. Because of everybody immediately around you.
Yeah, and I remember I visited you about 4 days after that because I had a flight. I had to get out of there.
Unbelievable. I really can't believe that you flew so soon.
Well, it was about a week after, and you drove me to JFK, and I remember nobody was in the airport, and I made a joke that you could hear the bartender putting ice in the glasses because everybody was nervous about flying. And I got I had paid for the flight already, so they had to come through on it, and I flew Lufthansa. I was maybe one of 10 people in a flight. you know, nobody wanted to fly. And but that was really a change. And we can get back to the Beastie Boys, yeah, because it's hard to be middle-aged guys being a hip-hop band, and they made a pretty good adjustment in the Okay, Ira, how would you say about the Beastie Boys? Because they reached middle age. It's 2000. They're going into new century. There's the music is completely changing. Nobody has a top 40 anymore. The MTV has changed. Why did the Beastie Boys survive into the early 2000s? What did they do? Yeah.
I think probably the reason they survived was that their musical sound stayed relevant. And so they didn't end up making any albums that were rehashes at attempts for success, and they kept transforming themselves. And I think they realized, you know, one of the indicators of that was that once they started playing their own instruments again, even though they still made hip hop records after that or hip hop tracks, was that they were capable of playing their instruments in a way that they would do a song that was an instrumental that didn't involve any rapping or any words. Mm-hmm. And they would be able to put that on an album. In fact, they released an entire album of instrumentals called The Mix Up. And so it's just incredible that, you know, they could go from for initial record that sounded great, but was very, very verbal, to developing into musicians that would play their own instruments that actually were without need to vocalize over them.
Yeah. And I saw them on a PBS talk show, a very, you know, sophisticated talk show, and they were completely different in 2007 than they were in 1987. And I think we all go through that in life, right? We all kind of learn from our mistakes, and we're not kids anymore. And I think it was kind of charming to see them, you know, reaching middle age and not being jerks anymore. Like on Joan Rivers, they're on a PBS talk show, and they kind of did something that we all wish we could do. They improved themselves a little bit, and they regret things a little bit, but they still made the best of what they had. And they cashed in on life. A pretty good story. Yeah,
definitely. I mean, I think that they grew up, and we, you know, because you said you're the same age as them, and I am approximately as well. We all grew up together, and it, you know, later on at different times they sort of disavowed the characters that they were during that License to Ill period. But you know, it's like when you first have sex, you know, it's like License to Ill. When you first have sex, it's like having sex in the back of a car. And then like at Paul's Boutique period, you realize that you mature, you can have sex in a bed. But they're different, but do you ever regret having the sex in the back of the car? That's just how it starts, you know?
Yeah, life is like that. I mean, we're all 19 at some point, and we all kind of regret being 19, but we all wish we were 19 again sometimes, you know? And I think that's part of life. And I think there are very few bands that in our generation that have survived from 1981 to the present. And I think probably they're the only one. Could you think of another one?
You know, their last album was 2011, right before MCA passed away. It's called Hot Sauce Committee. It charted at number 2, and that was 24 years after License to Ill. So it's hard to imagine, you know. I think there are some stars that have that sort of longevity, but it's few and far between.
And I saw them on their book tour, because the whole purpose of this, we talked about just being a book review, and you read the book, right? And
the book was amazing.
And we'll kind of close with this. I think they kind of regret some of the things they did in life, but they're pretty positive guys. You know, they've done okay. Would you say that's the case?
Absolutely. Yeah. I think that it's, you know, I'm unsure if the story is inspirational because of how unique they are and you know how random some of the things happen are. So I'm unsure if, like, for people reading it, if they would be inspired by the events of it. But it's definitely heartening to read the retelling of, you know, very human circumstances that they live through. And it's just you know, like their music, it's good and it's funny as hell.
I've told you before that you kind of remind me of Ad Rock. I mean, visually, physically, you kind of look like him, but your sense of humor is the same. He's one of the few guys that I think he's one of, he's my age, and I think he's one of the guys who can tell a story better than anybody I can tell. Like, when he tells a story, he tells it with his face as much as with his words. He's really a funny guy.
Yeah.
And I think you can't teach that.
Yes, he's transcendently funny. Yeah.
Yeah. And he's come a long way. And I think he's kind of the elder statesman. He's getting gray now, but he still has that kind of sparkle in his eye. Like, he can really tell a good story. And
oh yeah, he really does. I got to see the first show where they tried to put on a live performance of the Beastie Boys book. And it was in Philadelphia a couple years ago when Spike Jonze was live directing it. You know, they ended up making a documentary for based on like the show as it got more developed. And they were so excited to be on stage and telling those stories, and they were so funny, and the audience was so excited. And the only thing that was missing was the most important thing of all, which was the music. You know, they just were the musicians, but they were unable to do that part of their art. But the telling of their stories was really magical to see it in person.
But in some ways, Iren, we'll close it here. Thanks for joining us, and I really appreciate it, because you're the closest thing to the Beastie Boys I know. You actually met Ad Rock, and you won't tell the story. Why won't you tell the story? You met him.
I won't tell the story because it's one to go without commoditization, and so no pictures, no documentation. But I can say that I'm somebody who's uninterested in meeting the people that are important artists. But this one I couldn't pass up. And it was just in passing, but I will say, in my very, very brief afternoon of being in Ad Rock's company, he was the most amazing, gracious, funny, athletic, understated person that you could ever, want somebody that you admired to be. And I'm glad that will be the one and only time that I interact with him.
You met him at a New York softball game, right? I won't go into any details, but it's something like that, right?
Or, I met him on a New York playground, which seems to be fitting for me to be Beastie Boys.
And you weren't disappointed. Yeah, he was a good guy. Yeah.
Yeah, he was a great guy.
And I'm really happy about that, because we can sum up here. I don't think there's many bands that can tell a 30-year story and write a 600-page book that people would be interested in, and they did it. And Chuck D from Public Enemy says they're the real thing. There's people on the internet that say they're the best hip-hop band, rock band nexus that's ever been. And who am I to say? I just know that they've survived, and I'm not going to say they weren't privileged kids. They were, obviously, but they did something with it. There's a lot of privileged kids that waste their lives, and they didn't. And maybe we can end on a positive note like that.
Absolutely. I mean, the appeal that they would have to end up having a kid from Oildale learn to love their music while working in an Alaska cannery is pretty broad.
I still remember, Ira, when I met you in Alaska, you told me that I would like Paul's Boutique, and I said, man, I don't want anything to do with the Beastie Boys.
I remember you saying that.
And I said, I don't want to listen to this. I heard those guys. I don't want to listen to a bunch of frat guys. And you said, just give it a chance. Give it a chance. And you told me something I'll never forget, and maybe we can leave it on this, because you told me a lot of things that I remember years ago working in a fish cannery in Alaska, but you always told me something about first impressions. Do you remember that thing you told me?
First impressions are frequently wrong, so I'm not one for first impressions.
And you told me they're almost always wrong, so never listen to them. All right. Okay, Ira, thank you. It's been great to touch base with you.
Thank you so much.
And say hello to Gilda. Where's Gilda, your cat? Can you bring her back?
I think she's sleeping. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, good night, Ira, and it's been a pleasure, and we'll talk to you soon. We're going to get together again. He went for his to find, he didn't have one. Put him in check, correct, my head good. Hey, a symbol of life, a course that dies, a bus out to white. I pulled out the